Hi, everybody. My name is Katherine Grant, and I am a communications coordinator at the Center for Celiac Research and Treatment at MassGeneral Hospital for Children. We are really excited today to bring you this monthly vlog with Dr. Alessio Fasano. This is such an important topic that we really get a lot of questions on in our celiac disease clinic and online in our social media forums, just referring to the diagnostic process for celiac disease. So how is celiac disease diagnosed? So we're going to jump right in with Dr. Alessio Fasano and ask you to please just kind of cover the basics on how and when these tests are used for celiac disease.
So the diagnosis of celiac disease is based on clinical evidence. So in other words, to have somebody that has signs and symptoms, compatible with celiac disease. And then a screening test, that is the blood test that looks for specific markers. There are antibodies against a protein, it's called tissue transglutaminase, or TTG for short. That is an easy and quick way to screen people with signs and symptoms compatible with celiac disease. If you test positive having those symptoms, or if you belong to a risk categories like first degree relatives, even without symptoms, the next step is the confirmation of the diagnosis by means of an endoscopy. So in other words, evidence of the autoimmune insult that you can see by doing an endoscopy that allows to take a piece of the intestine and look under the microscope to confirm the diagnosis. In general, the third pillar, i.e. the genetics, is not used under normal circumstances because with these three steps, clinical evidence, screening test, confirmation by endoscopy, this is more than enough for the diagnosis. We do genetics when there are situations in which, we have doubts or we have, complicated situation that will require to know if you're genetic compatible. For example, if people that they have sinus symptoms of celiac disease, they decide to go on a gluten-free diet before they do the screening test and then a confirmatory endoscopy, doing the genetics will tell us if indeed you're genetically compatible and therefore you need to go back to do a gluten-free challenge to make the diagnosis. Or, for example, for first degree relatives, they're higher risk to develop celiac disease, and therefore there's an indication, no matter if they have symptoms or not, to be screened with a blood test. And if they test negative, the question is now what? So at that point, you want to do a genetic test to answer the question, well, if you're genetic compatible, you keep an eye on these folks. If they are not, it's pretty much useless to continue screening for celiac disease because the chance to develop celiac disease with those genes is almost nil.
Thank you. And can you explain what happens in the cases where a patient's blood test results might come back inconclusive?
If there is a clear positive, test or a clear negative test, of course, the problem does not really stand. Even if a negative test doesn't completely rule out celiac disease, because these are very robust tests, but not infallible. That's the reason why we want the confirmation by endoscopy. Roughly 10% of people with celiac disease, they can test negative, still have celiac disease. If you have a borderline positive or questionable test, then here the clinical acumen come at play in the sense that if you don't have any other explanation of the signs or symptoms that your patient has, and therefore you don't have any alternative diagnosis, an endoscopy will be worthwhile anyhow. One, because again, you can rule in or rule out celiac disease by doing that, but also because you can look at other causes of the symptoms, particularly if they are GI symptoms, by doing an endoscopy so that you can take many birds with one stone.
Thanks, Dr. Fasano. I mean, you just painted a really clear picture of what happens when patients' blood test results come back inconclusive or when they might not give us all the answers yet. But sometimes, as you and I both know, patients' blood test results will come back and they'll be strongly positive for celiac disease. So why is an intestinal biopsy still required to diagnose these patients with celiac disease?
That's a good question. The answer is because, as I said, a strongly positive test is not 100%. It's very, very close to 100% sure that you have celiac disease, but not 100%. And this diagnosis implies a change in lifestyle for life. So you can't build your house on sand. You need solid rock. So that's the reason why confirmation by endoscopy, no matter how remarkable is, the blood test needs to be done. Now, recently, and only for the pediatric population, the European Society for Pediatric Gastroenterology, Hepatology, and Nutrition proposed a possible, you know, algorithm to avoid the endoscopy. The algorithm goes like this. If you have a positive TTG that is 10 times more than normal, if you, beside this, you do another test that for celiac disease is called the anti-endomysium antibodies, and that's also positive. If you add the genetics, so you do the gene testing and they are compatible, then and only then you can confirm the diagnosis of celiac disease in pediatric patients. But again, you have to fulfill these three criteria. 10 times more TTG than normal, positive anti-endomysium, genetic compatibility of the HLA DQ2 DQ8. That is the only case in which symptomatic, and you have to have symptoms as well, kids may avoid an endoscopy. For adults, this algorithm has not been validated, and there's still recommendation to do an endoscopy. Now, the problem is that many times we have seen, unfortunately, cases in which the pediatrician and not the pediatric gastroenterologist take the matter in his or her hands and will do a testing for TTG that is not 10 times more than normal. They don't do, the anti-endomysium antibodies or the genetics. And based on this, new algorithm, they conclude inappropriately, I have enough evidence to put these kids on a gluten-free diet without doing endoscopy. This is much more harmful than actually the endoscopy per se.
Thanks, Dr. Fasano. So you just mentioned the EMA test, the endomysial antibody test, which is another blood test for celiac disease. And I think it'd be really helpful if you could just quickly explain the differences between this EMA test and the TTG test, which people may be more familiar with.
The reason why we recommend routinely the TTG test, they look at the same thing. The TTG test is done by a machine, so it's automated. So you take the blood, you put in a machine, and the machine will read the results. The anti-endomysium antibodies is operator dependent, because now you take the blood, you put on a very specific slide with a background tissue from which this antibodies will bind to, and you look under the microscope for the presence of these antibodies. So you have to make a subjective call there, and you need to be good to really understand what is positive, what can be a false positive. So much more expensive, time consuming, operator independent, the anti-endomysium antibodies. TTG, much cheaper, fast, operator independent.
Okay, and how often do you recommend the patients be tested for celiac disease?
It depends on what kind of subject you're talking about. If we're talking about kids, a test can be repeated also not very frequently, provided that at least you do this before the onset of puberty. Because if kids, they start puberty having celiac disease, the risk is that they will not, use fully their genetic potential to grow. So you want to avoid that. So the frequency also depends on symptoms. If these kids are asymptomatic, again, you can just wait until puberty or just before puberty starts. If they are symptomatic, and again, they are not any other explanation, more frequent, like once a year, or even more frequent if the symptoms they become very serious, it's appropriate. And as I said before, in lieu of negative tests, even if, you don't have a reason to suspect celiac disease, there is still a possibility of false negativity. And if you don't have any alternative, reason why the kids have these symptoms, an endoscopy is clinically indicated, because you want to rule out celiac disease as many, as well as any other cause of the symptoms that the kids may have that you can find by endoscopy.
one really central theme that we hear from patients who have been diagnosed with celiac disease and just in the community at large is that it can sometimes take a long time between when a patient experiences symptoms and or first suspects that they may have something going on to when they are actually diagnosed with celiac disease. So I think it would be interesting to hear from you as a clinician about why this journey can take such a long time, especially compared to diagnosing other GI conditions.
Well, Catherine, this is the consequence of the fact that, unfortunately, compared to many autoimmune diseases, the clinic will not point you in the right directions. You know, if you have diabetes, it's pretty obvious that you go to the bathroom very often, you drink a lot, can't be anything else but diabetes. If you have rheumatoid arthritis, and you start to have joint pain and difficulty walking, can be anything but, you know, that kind of autoimmune problem. But when you talk about celiac disease, you talk a variety of sinus symptoms that, you know, does not really point the right direction. So again, a clinic does not help. And for that reason, together with the poor awareness in the past, thankfully not the case anymore, The time between the onset of the symptoms that somebody would make the diagnosis was measured in the order of 12, 30 years. We're not there anymore, thankfully. But we're still talking about years and not months or weeks. And this really aggravates people tremendously. And that's the reason why we at the Center for Celiac Research and Treatment for many years have been advocating with our colleagues to use a very low threshold to do a blood test for celiac disease. It's cheap, it's fast, it's cost effective, and will be a good investment with a pretty strong return when used wisely.
Great, thank you. And that's a good segue into our last question we have for you, which is, what do you believe the future holds for celiac disease testing?
So I believe that from the test for the diagnosis, we are, you know, our toolbox is full of, you know, tests that are very strong, as we said, very reliable, easy to interpret, and therefore for the diagnostic, I believe we're all set for the screening and the confirmation. Already we've been making some strive to avoid the endoscopy if there are the conditions that we spelled out eventual, you know, conditions to spare the diagnosis, the endoscopy, at least in kids. The future that I see much more interesting is monitoring. So, you know, once you go on a gluten-free diet, I can now make sure that I'm doing okay. Right now, we use the TTG antibodies that we want to see to go back to normal. But we know now that while it's very robust for diagnosis, it's not as good for monitoring. So we have seen many cases of, you know, persistent high TTG antibodies. We do an endoscopy, it's absolutely normal. And we've seen the opposite. So the TTG back to normal, you do an endoscopy, there's still damage there. So I see, and there is a lot of effort, for the future in terms of monitoring more than diagnosis to find biomarkers that will tell you more faithfully what's happening in your guts in terms of inflammation, that can eventually spare to do, you know, repeat endoscopies. That's one thing that I can see coming. And then, you know, there are these tests to check for cross-contamination of gluten in the stools or urine that are, you know, good tools eventually to explain why people, despite they are strictly gluten-free without cheating, they may still have antibodies, they are positive, they may still have symptoms. That's something else that we're going to use, I believe, more and more routinely in a clinical setting for diagnosing why people they still have symptoms or why the antibodies seem positive.
Thank you so much, Dr. Fasano, for taking the time to talk with us today. Again, I think this is a really important topic that a lot of people may have some confusion about, and I think that's normal considering there's a lot of factors and a lot of different steps that go into diagnosing celiac disease. So thank you again, and we look forward to talking with you for next month's blog.